Hello everyone and welcome back. My name is Aurav Mutha and I'm bringing to you very, very good revision lectures for CA Inter. If you're a CA Inter student, then this one is just for you. If GST is something that bothers you, if registration chapter is something that feels too big, I'm going to bring to you a revision lecture that covers it all. Doesn't matter where you go to study, doesn't matter which faculty you study under or which book you're referring to, all you have to do is watch this lecture till the end. I'll cover every section. I'll give you shortcuts to remember everything in every section of registration chapter of GST. Plus, we will solve 1, 2, 3, 4, almost about 4 questions from CA Inter exams. That's right. Watch this till the end. Watch it before you start looking at the chapter, or even if you finish the chapter, watch it to do a quick revision. My company SMAT brings you very, very good revision lectures. So watch all the lectures of GST that I've been uploading, and that'll really, really help you in the exam, especially one day before the exam. So here we go. Today's topic is registration, and let's master how GST does registration. We look at a lot of questions. We look at a lot of shortcuts. Everything happens in this revision video. Here we go, guys. Welcome back. All right. So this is the registration chapter. It's one of the chapters in GST, and it's really, really important. It also comes with CA final, but let's tackle CA Inter for now. Registration has a lot of sections, sections 22 to section 30. And if you see the module or any of your book of your faculties, it looks like a really, really big book. So hence, these are the different sections. Sections 22 to sections 30, they tell you when should you take registration. They tell you who is supposed to be compulsory registered. Who tells you someone who does not need registration? Which hotline number do you dial to get registration? And how do you give up your registration if you don't want to continue your business? And can the GST offices also take away your registration? All that and more is happening right here in this chapter called registration. So let's tackle the first section. The first section is section 22. And which tells you that you need to be registered under GST. Our example will be electric bike company. Electric bike company, the moment it starts, does it need to take registration? Not really. So section 22 tells you the monetary limits, the turnover limits. And if you cross a particular turnover, only then you need to register under GST. Guys, lots of people have different ways of remembering those states. But you know, those limits of 20 lakh, 10 lakh, 40 lakh is really, really painful. Thankfully, we have a shortcut for that. So section 22, the moment in the exam, they give you a person like electric bike company and they ask you whether, you know, they should be registered or not. You have to first calculate aggregate turnover. What is aggregate turnover is something that you've already seen in a different chapter, but I will just recap what is aggregate turnover. Aggregate turnover is your turnover from every supply that you make, whether it is exempt supply, taxable supply, non-taxable supply, export supply. Any supply that you make, outward supply, it will be part of aggregate turnover, except 3 things will not be a part of aggregate turnover. GST on the supply will not be a part of aggregate turnover. The interest that you earn will not be a part of aggregate turnover. And any inward supplies you have will not be a part of aggregate turnover. So these 3 things will not be a part of aggregate turnover. Otherwise, everything will be aggregate turnover. Also, when you have aggregate turnover, it is basically one pan, one turnover. What do I mean by one pan, one turnover? That means for electric bike company, if they have one entity in Maharashtra, one in Gujarat, and one in Tripura, then all the 3 entities, aggregate turnovers, you have to see together. So to add up the aggregate turnover. All right. So once you calculate the aggregate turnover in the exam, they will give you diesel supply. They will give you oil supply. They will give you petrol supply. They will give you alcohol supply, and they will try to confuse you, but don't get confused. Aggregate turnover is the addition of everything, taxable, non-taxable, exempt, export. Whether you're sending it goods to Mars also, guys, it will be included in aggregate turnover, except 3 things will not be included. Once you calculate that, you keep that aside and you go to the 3 steps that you and me know. If you don't know it, guys, I'll tell you the first step. First step is check if the company is doing PIGS, P-I-G-S. What is this PIGS? This is a shortcut, guys, for 40 lakh. If you're doing PIGS, then you have a turnover of 40 lakh, turnover limit of 40 lakh. Up to that limit, you don't have to be registered. So what is this PIGS? First thing, you don't have to be selling prohibited goods, not manufacturing. You don't have to deal in prohibited goods. Prohibited goods basically means 2 things I really like. Aerated water, I love my thumbs up, and ice cream, pan masala, and tobacco and tobacco products. That you should not be trading. Next, you should not be trading interstate. That means from one state to the other, you should not be. You should only be doing intrastate. That does not mean I can't have different entities. Maharashtra entity can supply in Maharashtra, Gujarat entity can supply in Gujarat, and Tripura entity can supply in Tripura. Next, I should only be selling goods, no services, no, not even 1% services, no marginal services, only and only goods you should be servicing. And I should not be in some states, which states I'll tell you, but I should not be in some particular states. And if that happens, congratulations, your limit is 40 lakh. That means up to 40 lakh of turnover, you don't have to register. Again, turnover is turnover of all entities together under the same pan. Now, which are the states for this? Let me just tell the states for the step one. The states as you should not be in no tax magaj mari, NTMM. You should not be in these four states, Nagaland, Tripura, Manipur, Mizoram. I repeat, you should not be in Nagaland, Tripura, Manipur, or Mizoram. These four states you should not be. Also, you should not be in Put Sam. What is Put Sam? Put is Puducherry, down south, Uttarakhand, up north, Telangana, again down south. And Sam is basically Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, and Meghalaya. These six states, you cannot be in these four states. Also, you cannot be. Only if you're not in these states, guys, then you'll get 40 lakh limit. So when I say you should not be in some states, which states am I talking about? NTMM, Nagaland, Tripura, Manipur, Mizoram. And Put Sam, Puducherry, down south, Uttarakhand, up Telangana, down south again. And back in the northeast, Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur. This is northeast. This is south, north, south. And these are four states that will come again. Only if you're not in these states, then 40 lakhs. That is your step one. I hope you understood step one. The moment you have step one, you have 40 lakhs turnover. Step two, if you're not in step one, only then you go to step two. And step two, if you are in NTMM, if you're in any of these states, what if I'm in Maharashtra and Gujarat and in Tripura, then you are in these states. So even if one leg of your entities is in this state, NTMM, then straight away your limit is just 10 lakhs. Yes, a very, very small 10 lakhs. And if you're not in step one and you're not in step two, then automatically you're in step three. And step three says that you have a limit of only and only 20 lakhs. So you don't have to remember any states and any limit. You have to just remember this. Step one, pigs, no prohibited goods, only in, no interstate, only goods, and no none of these states, NTMM puts them. NTMM, then 10 lakhs. And step three, by default, it is 20 lakhs. This is what section 22 says. Guys, you can take any sum. Any sum, and you'll be able to do this. Just ensure that your PAN is per turnover. Sorry, your turnover is per PAN, and you also ensure your aggregate turnover you're calculating really well. Next, by section 22, we'll complete the section. The section 22, there are two more parts. Section 22 says that in case you are having any succession, that means like you were running the business, now someone else is running. So from the date of transfer, you need to apply for a fresh registration. Why? Because registration is PAN based. We will see in section 25. But you know, date of transfer will be the date on which you have to apply for a fresh registration. And another thing, they are section 22 says, in case of amalgamation, demerger, etc., then in that case, the date that is given by the court, the date, that date, or the date of incorporation of the next entity, that is the date where a fresh registration will be required. This is not really the most important. What is important is these limits, pigs, step two and step three. These are three things that will really be helpful in the exam. In the exam, all you have to quote, you can, of course, you can't quote pigs and all. So all you have to quote is you have to first line state that the aggregate turnover of XYZ entity in the year is 42 lakhs or 38 lakhs or whatever is the aggregate turnover. Then you have to state that since a person has a unit in Tripura, then the aggregate threshold limit is only 10 lakhs. And since the turnover is more than 10 lakhs, it needs compulsory registration. It's very simple, guys. You don't need to complicate it. Of course, these are steps for you and me to solve, not in the exams, but this will really, really help you to get an answer very, very quickly and the right answer. Next. So you have to register under 22. Yes, you have to register. I'm just putting the sections here, guys. So we're done with 22 section where you require registration, but it's not that immediately you require registration. Here you get registration only if you cross a certain threshold. We will come to 23, but right now it's time to go to 24. Guys, 24 is a very dangerous section, not for you and me. We have a shortcut for that, but for others, because here, the moment you do any of these things, you have to compulsory register. So section 24 talks about compulsory registration. That means shouldn't I wait for my turnover to cross 20, 10, 40 lakhs? No, you don't have to wait for any turnover. The moment you do any of these things, you have to compulsory register. The shortcut for this is, I'm just going to go to a new page for this section. I'm going to come back here. But right now, we're looking at section 24. Section 24 is dealing with compulsory registration. And it has a very, very interesting shortcut. The shortcut says ensure compulsory registration is needed. So very logical. But whom are they telling this to? Whom are they telling this to ensure? Tonai. There's a guy called Tonai, and they're asking him that ensure compulsory registration is needed, Tonai. That is what is being asked. Let's see what this is. First, this is the shortcut. First, E for ensure, E for e-commerce operator. If you are an e-commerce operator, example, you are Uber, you are Make My Trip, you are UrbanClap, then you need to be get registered. If you're not one of these, but you are selling on e-commerce websites, example, I'm selling this pen on Amazon, then I need to be registered as well. So not just e-commerce operators, but sellers on e-commerce operators also need compulsory registration. Yes, compulsory registration. So do I look for turnover? No, you don't have to look for turnover. Next, casual taxable person. Who's a casual taxable person? I'll tell you, casual taxable person is a person who's registered in one state, example, Maharashtra, or Gujarat or Tripura, but temporarily they want to make supplies in another state. Example, there's an exhibition happening in Delhi and they want to participate there. They require compulsory registration. Next, R. If you are someone who needs to pay GST to the government under RCM, that means you're receiving some goods or you're receiving some services, but unfortunately you're the recipient and the burden and the headache is on you. So you need to compulsory register, because how can you pay to the government unless you're registered? So you need to compulsory register. So RCM recipient has to be compulsory registered. Next, fourth one, if you're supplying anything from one state to the other, the government wants you to be compulsory registered, but there are two exceptions here. So again, guys, any interstate movement you're making of goods or services, the government wants you to be compulsory registered, except two exceptions here. What are the exceptions? If you're doing interstate services, example, if I provide my CA services or I provide my lectures interstate to other states up to 20 lakhs, no problem. And if I send handicraft goods, what are handicraft goods? Handicraft goods are notified handicraft goods, which are generally made by hand. And if I send handicraft goods again up to 20 lakhs, then interstate, those are two exceptions for them, up to 20 lakhs. These two exceptions are there, but they are exceptions only up to 20 lakhs. They are exceptions. So if you're selling services interstate, no problem, up to 20 lakhs, you don't need to compulsory register. And if you're selling handicraft goods, including in another states, no problem, up to 20 lakhs. Next, if you're a non-resident taxable person, who's a non-resident taxable person? Someone who does not have a fixed place of business in India, but temporarily wants to do business in India. Example, Tesla participating in that exhibition in Delhi of electric bikes. Next, sixth one. Tonight, T. If you're someone who is responsible to deduct TDS or collect TCS, this is not the TDS or TCS in income tax, which we see in DT, but this is TCS and TDS of income, ITC of GST, which you will see at CA final. But right now, we have to just remember this TDS and these TCS guys need to be compulsory registered. Next, the seventh guy is O. O is OIDAR. This is almost like Google. Online information database access and retrieval services. That means, guys, you want to know how many people are searching for electric bikes online. So you ask Google to give you that information. Online information database, they will tap the database, they will access the database, and they will retrieve that information for you, and they will charge you some money. So these are called online information database access and retrieval service providers, and they need to be compulsory registered. Next, N, notified people. If the government notifies certain people, then those persons need to be compulsory registered. This we don't have to get into details. Next, agent. If you're an agent, guys, you know in GST who's an agent. An agent is the one who issues his own invoice, who basically makes independent supplies. Example, if you buy electric bikes from the electric bike company and you sell it to customers under your own invoice, then you're an agent. Then in that case, you're an agent of a taxable person. What is agent of a taxable person? That means your principal, whomever is selling you goods or giving you services, that person is taxable. That means that person is registered. Then even you got to be compulsory registered. And last, the 10th one is something again that will come at CA final, but you also just need to know the name, the detail, and the fact that they need to be compulsory registered. A person called input service distributor. Who is this person and what is he doing? We'll see more at CA final, but I'll give you a brief background about who is an input service distributor. An input service distributor is someone like Tata Sons. They have a lot of inputs. They buy software. They buy a lot of things on which they get ITC. But because they don't have any output supply, guys, Tata Sons does not supply anything. They only invest in other Tata companies. So they don't make any supplies. So how will they use this ITC? They can't use it. So the government allows such people to distribute the ITC. That's what is called input service distributor. They can distribute this IT to certain people, but we will see that in CA final. All you got to remember right now is they need to be compulsory registered, and that is section 24. So in case, guys, this can be a trick question in the exam, in case they say that Mr. XYZ or Messrs. XYZ and Co. is supplying footwear from Haryana. They supply all over India and they'll give you details of aggregate turnover. Please remember, the moment it is interstate, it is compulsory. So please, whenever you check for registration, don't just stop at 22, also check 24. So 22 and 24 both are for registration. Yes, both are for registration. So 22 is also for registration and 24 is also for registration. Perfect. So we're done with two sections already. Now, you know, this 22 section and this 24 section is not liked by some people. Some people, example, a poor farmer who's farming, who's growing wheat, who's growing pulses and who's selling it. He feels, listen, why should you want me to register, you know, when I cross a certain threshold, or why do you want me to be compulsory registered? So the government hears them. This is basically non-registration. Those people which do not have to register, this is basically they get an exemption from registration. They do not have to register ever. Yes, ever. Let's see what this is. Let's go to the next section, guys. This is section 23. Section 23 says that those people who do not require registration, that is, registration is not required in the following cases. Now, who are these people and what does the government do? The government says, don't worry, we are going to hear you out. We have heard you. The government hears them. And the government says, I have heard you and now I will not let you register. I don't want you to register. So guys, if you don't register, you don't charge GST. You don't have to file returns. You don't have to do any formalities. In fact, you don't have to study GST also. So what are these five people who the government has heard? First is handicraft people. If you're selling handicraft goods, the government says, I have heard you. Do not register up to 20 lakh rupees, up to 20 lakh rupees maximum. Do not register. So can I sell in any other state? Yes. Can I sell in any exhibition? Yes. You can even be a casual taxable person also, CTP also, but maximum up to 20 lakhs. And guys, handicraft goods are something that are made by hand, not by machines. Next, E. If you're only going to sell exempt goods, example, you're a hospital, you only sell, give exempt services. Or if you're a farmer and you only give exempt goods, or if you're someone who's selling milk and you only sell exempt milk, then in that case, why do you need to register? So no registration up to 20 lakhs? No, never. No registration ever. Next, what if you're an agriculturalist? Guys, what is an agriculturalist? Agriculturalist is an individual or an HUF. It cannot be a company. Agriculturalist is an individual and HUF who cultivates. They actually work on the field. They cultivate, they grow and they sell. They don't trade, guys. They grow and they sell. That is an agriculturalist. And you know exemption chapter. If you don't know, watch my video, revision video on exemption. In agriculturalist also, because it is exempted, they don't have to register. Next, if you're providing any goods or services which are taxable under RCM, example, if you're a lawyer and you provide services to the electric bike company, then electric bike company has to bear the burden and the headache. You don't have to bear any of that. Then why do you want to register? You don't need to register. And last is S, services. Again, handicraft and services both were exceptions. So we already had spoken about it. I'm just giving you details here. So in case you're giving services, do I need to register? Do I need to be compulsory? Up to 20 lakhs, you don't need to register. So up to 20 lakhs, you don't need to register. Even interstate, yes, even interstate, up to 20 lakhs, you don't need to register. So these five people, the government hears them and says this, listen, you don't have to get registered. Perfect. So that was section 23. So two sections for registration, 22, you need to be registered, 24, you compulsory need to be registered. Then thankfully, section 23 is a really, really happy section because these people either don't have to register at all, like agriculturalist, exempt, RCM, or they need to not register only after 20 lakhs. Okay, so now that you need to register, what is the procedure for registration, guys? What is the procedure? Procedure to batao. I want to register myself. How do I register myself? That is given in section 25. So let's look at section 25. All right. So 25 is procedure for registration. So let's see section 25. Section 25, the first one says that you need to apply for registration. and you need to apply within 30 days. Example, if today you started doing interstate supply of goods, or if today you became an ISD, or if today you became an agent of a person who was taxable, that means whenever you became liable to register, or today if you cross that limit of 10 lakh, 20 lakh, or 40 lakh, then you need to apply within 30 days for registration. After that, whenever you get the registration, don't worry. So let's say today is the 9th of October, you need to apply within 30 days. That is by the 8th of November, you need to apply. If you apply within that date, and let's say you get the registration also on 15 November, but don't worry, your effective date will still be 9th October, because you did what was supposed to be done. That is, you applied within 30 days. But what if you had to apply by 8th November, but you actually applied by 12th November? So you've gone beyond 30 days. So that's not a crime, honestly. But in that case, whenever you get your registration, let's say you get on 15 November, your effective date will be 15 November, not 9th of October, because you've done a delay. But what's the point? What's the problem with 15 November? Guys, you will get ITC only from 15 November. In the first case, you will get ITC from the 9th of October. The moment you register, guys, from the effective date, this is the concept of effective date. This is the concept of effective date. A question can come in the exam on which is the effective date. So hence, you should know this. Within 30 days, you have to apply. If you applied well, then whenever you get it, the effective date will be the earlier date when you are liable to register. Next, there's a hotline number to register, which I call 777. Guys, this is only a shortcut to remember. That whenever you file an application for registration, of course, everything has to happen online. So you go to the GST portal and you file for registration. Whenever you file for registration, earlier this was 3 days, now it has become 7 days. You have 7 days, not you, sorry. The GST officer has 7 days to either ask you for any mistake, clarification, etc., or for any information, or they have 7 days to accept. But what if they don't do anything? They don't even accept it. They don't even send you any query. Then deemed acceptance will happen in 7 days. Earlier, this period was 3 days, but that was too short, and hence they made it 7 working days. Next, once you get a notice for some information, etc., you have 7 working days to reply to it. Otherwise, deemed cancellation. And once you reply to the notice, again, they have 7 days to either accept it or reject it. They can't ask for more information. No, it's either accept or rejection. What if they don't do anything? Then again, deemed acceptance. Next, section 25.2 says that in every state, you need to take registration. So registration is state-wise. Yes, every state requires separate registration. In fact, in the same state also, although it's not required, but you may at your option have different registration. Let's say one place supplies electric bikes, the other place supplies electric scooters. So if you want two registrations, you can take two registration. That's your option. So state-wise, you compulsory have to take registration, different registration. In the same state, it's an optional. But if you have an SEZ in the same state, then it's compulsory. So guys, every SEZ requires a separate registration. Exception, SEZ. If you have an SEZ in the same state, even though you're registered in that state, you will have to take a separate registration for SEZ. Why? Because you'll see in CA final that SEZ is almost like export. Next, section 25.3. This is basically voluntary registrations. You are not supposed to register compulsory under 24. You have not crossed the threshold under section 22. But can you still voluntarily register? Yes. But why will you do that? Why will you make your bikes more expensive? Because you want ITC, hence you voluntarily register. Guys, if you know, if you don't register, you cannot charge GST. Also, you can't take ITC. Next is section 25.4 and section 25.5. I'm going to talk both of them together. If you are registered in Maharashtra and you're also registered in Gujarat, then those two entities are called deemed distinct persons. In fact, if you're in Maharashtra and you also have an entity in Gujarat, but in Gujarat it's a petrol pump, in the aggregate turnover, etc., you will cross, you will take it together. But registration you will take only in Maharashtra, not in Gujarat, because Gujarat sells non-taxable, so for that you don't require registration. Anyways, so those are deemed distinct persons. If you have different entities in different states, they're called deemed distinct persons. Next. 25.6, it takes 6 days to apply for a PAN. That's the shortcut for this. And why should you apply a PAN? Because unless you have a PAN, you cannot apply for registration. So PAN is compulsory, except if you're a non-resident taxable person, that's an exception. If you're a non-resident taxable person, then you don't have to have a PAN. That's okay. Then what do you use? You use someone else's, you give your passport copy and you give someone else's PAN. Next is section 25.6A, 6B, 6C and 6D. So many for what? For Aadhaar authentication. Guys, Aadhaar is slowly and steadily become very important for even for GST. So they want you to authenticate your Aadhaar when you apply for GST. What if you don't authenticate your Aadhaar? Then they will take 30 days. Earlier that was 60. Now they will take 30 days to actually verify your address. They might even do a physical inspection, that is upon the GST officer, and they get more days to actually verify it, because these guys, they don't want people who are frauds to just fly by night. They're called fly by night operators, fraud operators. They don't want them to suddenly get registration on the GST, and hence they want Aadhaar authentication. Next, 25.8 says that the GST officer can suo moto register you. If the officer feels that you should be registered, then he can suo moto register you. And if you really want to be registered after that, you can apply and convert that suo moto registration into proper registration. And if you don't agree to this, then you can also file an appeal against this. And next, 25.9 and 25.10, guys, there are embassies, consulates, and United Nations offices in India. In India, in BKC, in your city, there will be different consulates, different embassies. Guys, those are exempted. If you've seen the exemption chapter, you know the services provided by them is exempted. But if they buy an AC, they have to pay GST. So they feel very bad because their services are exempted, but they pay GST on inward supply. And hence the government says, for these people, they should get a unique identity number. And this unique identity number will be used by them to take a refund of the GST that they have paid. This, guys, is section 25. Very, very interesting and very simple, because it just tells you the procedure for registration. Check effective date is very, very important here. All right, let's move ahead to the next one. To section 26 is very, very simple. Before we do that, let me just see if there's anything. All right, just one more thing. Guys, when you register, you have to tell the government that in Maharashtra state, this is my principal place of business and this is my additional place of business. So at your discretion, you can designate anyone as a principal place and any other place as additional place of business. In fact, when you see at CA final, a job worker, the job worker can be an additional place of business, but CA inter students ignore that line. Next, guys, is section 26. So we are done with 23, 24, 25 also. And now next is section 26, which is really, really easy peasy, very, very easy section, section 26. I call it the Hum Saath Saath section. That means we are all in this together. What does section 26 say? Section 26 says that if you are registering under CGST, then you're automatically also registering under IGST, also under CGSGST, and also under UTGST, also under GST compensation says, yes, all of them you're registering under together. That means you don't have to make separate registration. Otherwise, guys, you'll go crazy registering it. So hence they say that everything is same registration. Also, if your registration is denied, then it's denied for all together. So hence this is Hum Saath Saath, all of them together. Next section is section 27. Section 27 is specifically for casual taxable person and non-resident taxable person. We know who these people are. Casual taxable person is someone who's registered in India in different states, but they temporarily want to make supply in another state, but they're not registered. And non-resident taxable person is basically not having a fixed place in India. That means they're not registered in India, but they want to make temporarily some supplies in India. These are called casual taxable and non-resident taxable person. You know, guys, under section 24, they require compulsory registration. They need to be compulsory registered. If you remember, ensure compulsory registration is needed tonight. In this, CTP and NRTP need to be compulsory registered. This section 27 only tells you how they will be registered. So first up, they need to be registered at least 5 days prior to business. So you cannot be starting that exhibition and then registering. 5 days before the start of business, you need to be registered. You need to make a separate application, and not just that, because you might run away from that state and the government finds it difficult to chase you, you need to make advance payment of GST. So based on an estimate, so you might think that, okay, I'll sell 100 bikes in this exhibition. So based on the estimate, you will have to pay GST in advance. Of course, if you don't sell so many, you will get a refund of the GST, no problem. And if you want to pay more, you can always pay more. Next, this registration is valid for 90 days or the period that you applied for. So let's say the exhibition is for 1 week. Can you apply for 1 week? Yes. But the registration of the exhibition is for 95 days. You can only get a registration for 90 days. This can be further extended. Yes, it can be further extended again by maximum 90 days. So basically 90 days maximum first time and 90 days maximum second time. This is casual taxable person and non-resident taxable. Compulsory registration, 5 days before they need to register, they need to give the details. Guys, non-resident taxable person will not even have a PAN. So they will give a passport and they will give PAN details or someone else who is basically dealing with them, some AFM person who is responsible for their business in India. That is section 27. 27 is basically only and only for casual taxable person and non-resident taxable person's registration. Perfect. We are now left with three other sections, 28, 29, 30. This is 28. Then there will be 29. And then there will be 30. Out of that, the main important section is 29, 28, and 30 are very, very simple. Let's move ahead and let's see what is section 28. Guys, it's only human to make mistakes. Also, it's only human to make changes. So sometimes your address might change. Sometimes your name of the entity might change. Sometimes your phone number, sometimes your email address, sometimes some other detail might change, which is there on the registration certificate. Guys, by the way, the registration certificate that comes to you has to be displayed prominently in your shop, in your office, etc. And also the GST number has to be displayed properly. That's why most of the shops you'll see have GST numbers written outside. Section 20 says that in case you want to make amendments to your registration, can you make amendments? Of course, you can make amendments. There are two kinds of amendments. One are core fields. Core fields are the one which are really, really important. What are the core fields and can you change them? Yes, you can change them. This is the shortcut can for core fields. Core fields basically means if your constitution is getting changed, that means if from your partnership firm, one partner is going out or one partner is being added, or one partner is no more, then that's a core field. Next, your address is changing. Either your additional place of business or your principal place of business address is changing, or your name is changing. That is core field. What about PAN changing? Guys, PAN changing, you cannot amend it. You need to make a fresh registration because registration is linked to your PAN number. So in these three cases, what do? The moment this change happens, within a period of 15 days, you need to apply for amendment. You need to actually apply for amendment. The officer will actually check whether this is right or wrong, because this could be a serious repercussion, and hence the government will check, the GST officer will check whether it is appropriate or not, and then he will amend the registration and you will get a new registration certificate which you have to frame and again put it in office. And what are non-core fields? Non-core fields are basically any other small fields. That means what business are you dealing in? Okay, what is your phone number? What is your email address, etc. Non-core fields, you don't require any approval. You can just amend it directly. But in case of phone number and email address, you will require an OTP verification in case of email address and mobile number. So this is section 28. Section 28 only talks about amendment to, this basically talks about amendments to your registration. Now, guys, let's come to section 29. Here, you're already registered. That means you're already registered. You've already applied. You've already dialed that number 777. You're registered. You're supplying goods. Life is good. You're filing your return. But something is a problem. Section 29 talks about canceling your registration. And canceling is a dangerous thing. Why is it a dangerous thing? If you yourself want to shut your business and you want to cancel, no problem. But if the GST officer by chance cancels your registration, guys, imagine all your Paytm money, all your ITC will suddenly disappear. And hence, it is difficult to digest the fact that they can also cancel your registration. Let's see how it works. First, we'll see the easy one, section 29.1. And then there is 29.2. So there are two sections of cancellation of registration. First one is voluntary registration, voluntary cancellation. Voluntary cancellation basically means you voluntarily want to cancel your registration. Why would you want to do that? Because let's say you're closing down the business. Sometimes business gets closed down. Or let's say you sold your business, or let's say you amalgamated your business, then what happens is the old registration has to be shut down. So you will make an application and that application will be reviewed by the officer, because guys, if he cancels it, then how will he chase you? So once you cancel, you have to apply, you may have to make an application for cancellation. The officer will have a look at it. He will ask you for details and then finally pass an order canceling your registration. In the application, you will write that from when do you want your registration canceled. So let's say you're applying today, that's 9th of October. And let's say you say, I want it canceled from the 1st of October. Then the officer will decide by when it has to be canceled. Generally, it is the later of the 2 days. When you apply for cancellation, then during the pendency of that procedure, where the officer is looking to your number, to your cancellation application, etc. In that process, he can also suspend. He may suspend your application. What is suspend, guys? If you've been in school and if you've ever been suspended, you know what is suspended. Suspended means temporarily he will cancel your registration. So what does that mean? That is during the period of suspension, you cannot make any supply. Yes, you cannot make any supply. Also, the good part is you don't have to file any returns because your registration is suspended. That may happen when you apply for cancellation. Guys, this is voluntary cancellation. This is no problem because you have only asked for cancellation. This is voluntary cancellation. But what if the cancellation is suo moto, by the officer. Suo motu cancellation by the officer. The officer feels he wants to cancel registration. When does that happen? I have a shortcut for that. If he feels, you can immediately commence 36 frauds. If he feels you can immediately commence 36 frauds, that means what? C is if you've contravened any provisions of the act. If you've done contravention of any provision of the act, then he may cancel it. I, if you've not issued invoice, if you've issued invoice without actually making a supply, so these are fake invoices. These are invoices, you've issued invoices to give someone credit, etc., but there is no supply. Next. You've not commenced business for 6 months, not commenced. For 6 months after you get the registration, you've not commenced business. Why? Why did you take registration then? Next, for 3 periods, you've not filed returns. If you're a casual taxable person, composition scheme dealer, and for 6 months, you've not filed your return. If you're another person other than composition scheme, or if you're trying to do some fraud or misrepresentation, in these cases, he can actually proceed to cancellation to proceed to cancel your registration. Guys, in this can immediately commence 36 frauds. Now we have to add 3 more. You already know it if you've seen my amendment lecture, or otherwise I'll tell you, we have to add 3 more. Can immediately commence 36 frauds. It's still there, but 3 more. What are the 3 more? Miss 99 ITC. Miss 99 ITC is the shortcut for the 3 more. So if your returns are mismatched, example, regularly your GSTR1 and your GSTR3B are mismatched. So in that case, he may feel that you are doing something wrong and he may ask for cancellation of a registration. Or if you're not following that rule 86B, what is that rule 86B? Rule 86B says that if in a particular month, your supplies are more than 50 lakh rupees taxable supplies, then the liability has to be met by credit. You can use credit, but only maximum 99%. Example, let's say your turnover this month was 60 lakh and you have 18% GST. So that is 10,80,000. Then 10,80,000, only 99%, that is 10,69,200, you can pay through credit. Some portion you have to pay through cash. That is rule 86B. If you don't remember it, watch my amendment video, which is there in the same playlist, and you will know what is rule 86B. This rule, if you're not following, or if you're taking ITC without fulfilling the conditions of section 16, then in that case, he may want to cancel your registration. But guys, he cannot surprise you one day suddenly saying, hey, listen, your registration is canceled. No, it is a process. He will issue you a notice, a show cause notice, asking you why your registration should not be canceled. And you can reply to it. He will give you an opportunity of being heard. And then finally, he will cancel your registration. But don't worry, if your registration is canceled here, it's dangerous because your credit, etc., goes away. But there is a next section which tells you how you can save yourself from that cancellation. So the next section talks about how you can save yourself. So this section 29 was cancellation. You can apply for cancellation. They can also cancel it. And this is revocation of cancellation. How you can beg them that, listen, please revoke my cancellation. Please don't cancel it. So this is section 30, which says revocation of cancellation. Guys, revocation can only happen when you have not applied for cancellation. If you have applied for cancellation, why will you beg them that, listen, please, don't cancel. So this is only when the officer cancels. Revocation of cancellation is only when the officer cancels your registration, you will apply for revocation. Basically, you will say that, listen, I know I've done some wrong. I know, of course, frauds and all, they will not allow. But you will say that, listen, I know I have not filed my returns. My CA was not well. I could not file my returns. Please revoke it. If you can make an application, then this application has to be made within 30 days. So whenever you come to know that your order, that your registration is canceled, within 30 days, you can apply for revocation. This can be further extended by another 30 days, which can be further extended by another 30 days. Why so many extensions? Because guys, dangerous. Cancellation is dangerous. And then they give you multiple opportunities to revoke it. How do you revoke it? If you have not filed your returns, and the period is open to file your returns, please file your returns. Please file your returns. And if the period is over, example, the registration is canceled since 1st of Jan, and from 1st of Jan till 30th June, you were doing business, but you have not filed your returns, then the moment they revoke your cancellation, that means they cancel, they get your registration alive, then within 30 days, you need to file your registration. So this basically will make your registration again come alive. But once it comes alive, whatever sin you've done, you have to clarify it. You have to wash your sins. If you've not filed your returns, please file your returns. If you've not commenced business, please commence business. If you've done something wrong, please rectify it. Generally, it's the returns that you need to file. You need to file, you get 30 days. Once your registration is alive, you get 30 days to file all your returns. Only then he will consider your registration to continue. Remember, guys, even if you cancel your registration, it's not that you know, you can enjoy your liability, you still have to pay. There is a final return under section 45, which you still have to file. So it does not mean once you cancel your registration, you don't have to pay anything. They will take the taxes from you. They will ask you to file the final return. All the formalities will still apply. In fact, when you cancel it, whatever stock that you have, the batteries, engines, and tires, which you had in stock, which were either in raw material form or semi-finished or finished form, plus the capital goods that you had, the government says, listen, you're shutting your business. So on this stock and on this capital goods, whatever ITC you've taken, reverse it. Or if you make a supply of this, if you supply it ahead, just 1 second. If you supply it ahead, then if you supply it ahead, that means these stock and capital goods, if you sell it, whatever ITC, whatever GST you have to pay, you have to pay that. So either reverse or pay whichever is higher. I repeat once, this last thing, not really most important at CENTER, but you should know, guys, once you cancel, what happens to the stock that you have? All the batteries, tires, engines, what happens to the trucks, etc., the capital goods you have? You've happily taken the credit of those. So hence the government says the credit will be reversed. Stock, whatever the stock is based on the invoices, the credit will be reversed. And capital goods, for how many ever quarters you've used it, 5% per quarter you'll be allowed and rest will be reversed. Or if you are planning to sell these, then on this, the sale, whatever GST is, that you'll have to pay. So whichever is higher, that you'll have to either reverse or pay. Means the same, you have to basically discharge the liability. Guys, that is section 30. Now I'm looking at some examination questions on this. Let's quickly see what are the examination questions on this. I'm looking at the Jan 21 paper. This is a 5-mark question on registration chapter. Under the provision of 29.1, read with rule 21A, rules are not important. Under mainly the sections are important, and mainly all the sections are of the CGST Act. Related to suspension of registration, if the registered person has applied for cancellation of registration, what is the period and manner of suspension of registration? Guys, whenever you apply for cancellation, the GST officer may, if he desires, he may cancel, he may suspend your registration during the pendency of proceedings of cancellation. During the proceedings of cancellation, while he's canceling a registration, he might suspend it. And what happens when it's suspended? When it's suspended, you will not be able to make any taxable supplies. Also, you will not have to file any returns. This will get you your marks here. Let's move to next question. I'm looking at the November 20 question. Guys, the November 20 question is here. Very, very important, guys. BBD Limited of Gujarat exclusively manufactures and sells product Z. So there's a company which is in Gujarat, and they are selling product Z, which is exempt from GST-wide notification issued under the relevant GST legislations. The company sells Z only within Gujarat, so only intrastate, and is not registered under GST. The turnover of the company in the previous year, 18-19, was rupees 50 lakh. That is, last year, it was 15 lakhs. The company expects the sales to grow by 10% in the current year, 19-20. But guys, till now, from a registration perspective, do they need to register? No, this is as per section 23. Because the supply is wholly exempt, for people who supply is wholly exempt, they don't need to register. Next. So will you check for 22? No, because 23 says if your supply is exempt and that's the only supply I'm making, then you don't need to register. However, guys, something tragic happened. From the 1st of January 2022, the exemption was withdrawn by the central government, and now 5% GST was imposed. The turnover of the company for the 9 months ended 31st December 2019 was 42 lakhs. So unfortunately, the exemption was withdrawn. Guys, there's a section called section 18. If you've seen my ITC, chapter, then in that there is a section called section 18. Section 18.1d says that if your exempt supply is now becoming taxable supply, which is happening here, then in that case, you need to make a registration. So here, what BBD is saying that they're not supposed to get registered during the financial year. Let's check. So first, till 31st December, they did not have to register. Till 31st December 2019, they did not have to be registered. Why? Because the supply was wholly exempt. And hence, as per section 23, they did not require registration. However, the moment it has become taxable, they will have to register. They will have to register if the turnover has exceeded a certain limit. How do you check that, guys? You check the aggregate turnover in the last year. So last year's aggregate turnover was 50 lakhs and they were in Gujarat and they were only selling product Z within the state. So is it pigs, prohibited good? No. Interstate? No. Only goods? Yes. Input SAM or NTMM? No. So congratulations, you have 40 lakhs, but you've exceeded 40 lakhs. You're already at 42 lakhs. Then in that case, you're already at 42 lakhs this year. Last year, you were at 50 lakhs. So hence, you need to be compulsory registered. Yes, you need to be compulsory registered. Nice. Oh, sorry, my bad. You don't need to check for last year. You have to check for this year. So the aggregate turnover till now, till the date, till 31st December is already 42 lakhs. So you've already crossed that 40 lakhs. So BBD, your opinion is wrong. You need to be compulsory registered because you've crossed the threshold of 40 lakhs. Had this 42 lakh been 38, you didn't have to register. All right. So let's look at one more. This is November 20. We've done two. Let's do two more. May 2019. Perfect. In that, question number 7. Yes. Registration chapter always gets you 4-5 marks, guys. And 4-5 marks out of 40 marks means 10% of your GST comes from this chapter. Mr. Raghav is engaged in wholesale cum retail trading of medicines in the state of Assam. His aggregate turnover during the financial year is 9 lakh, which consists of 8 lakh intrastate and 1 lakh is interstate. Does he have to register? That's what you have to say. Guys, for registration, the first step you need to check is he doing PIGS, P-I-G-S? Is he doing prohibited goods? No. Is he doing interstate? No. Is he doing only goods? Yes. And is he doing in the states of NT, MM or Put Sam? He is not doing in any of those states. And Nagaland, Tripura, Manipur, Mizoram, no. Puducherry, Uttarakhand, Telangana, no. Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya, no. Now, guys, what is his aggregate turnover? His aggregate turnover is 9 lakhs. His aggregate turnover is 9 lakhs. Do you take interstate? Yes, you take interstate both. Sorry, my bad. He's doing interstate supply. So it is compulsory registered, guys. My bad. I did not see that 24. I did not see that interstate. He's doing interstate supply. If you're doing interstate supply, they need to be compulsory registered. Section 24 says you need to be compulsory registered. So that is my first answer. Second, SN Gupta of Rajasthan is engaged in trading of taxable goods. Guys, just one thing I forgot to mention. In aggregate turnover discussion, aggregate turnover basically includes all your turnover. Yes, all your turnover. Aggregate turnover also includes if you're a principal, then your agents, or if you're an agent, then your principal supply is also your aggregate turnover. So Mr. S.N. Gupta of Rajasthan is engaged in trading of goods on his own account and also as an agent of Mr. Rishi of Delhi. So basically, this is S.N. Gupta. He's selling goods on his own account also and he's selling as an agent also. So should both be included as a turnover? Yes, both will be included in this turnover. His turnover in the financial year is 12 lakhs on his own account. 12 is here. And 9 lakhs on account of principal. So total aggregate turnover is 21 lakhs. Now let's check step 1, PIGS, P-I-G-S. Is he selling prohibited goods? They've not mentioned that. Is he only selling intrastate? Yes. Both turnovers are intrastate. Yes. So he's not selling interstate. Is it goods? Yes. And is he selling in one of those states? No, he's selling in Rajasthan. So his limit is 40 lakhs. Yes, his limit is 40 lakhs. Perfect. Perfect. So if his limit is 40 lakhs, then he does not have to register here. He does not have to register here. Perfect. Let's move to the next one. The last one is this one. Again, 7th question. Here, guys, this is Mr. Lepcha and Mr. Ahmed. Registration requirements, again, 5 marks. Every year it comes consistently. Mr. Ahmed of Jammu engaged in business of supplying tobacco-based pan masala with an aggregate turnover of 24 lakhs. So first, they've already given you aggregate turnover, so you don't have to calculate. Step 1, is it PIGS? Yes, it is PIGS, prohibited goods. So I cannot be 40 lakhs, no. And then step 2, am I in NTMM, Nagaland, Tripura, Manipur, Mizoram? No. So automatically I'm in 20 lakhs turnover and this is 24 lakhs. So do I need to register? Yes, you need to register. Please go online and register. Next. Mr. Lepcha of Mizoram is engaged in the supply of papers with the aggregate turnover 13 lakhs. They've already given you aggregate turnover. Step 1, is it PIGS? Is it prohibited goods? No. Is it interstate? The papers, they've not said, but let's assume, guys, he's not selling interstate. Is it only goods? Yes. Is it in one of those states? Nagaland, Tripura, Manipur, Mizoram? Yes, he's in one of those states. So he'll go to step 2. And step 2 says 10 lakh is the limit. You're already at 13 lakh. You have to register. But what if you're in Meghalaya? Will this answer change? Guys, NTMM, Nagaland, Tripura, Manipur, Mizoram, they're not in one of those. So you're not in step 1. PIGS. You're in one of the states. NTMM is not Meghalaya, but PUTSAM is Meghalaya. Puducherry, Uttarakhand, Telangana, Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya. So you're not in step one. Step two is not applicable for you because you're not in NTMM. So automatically step three is applicable. That is 20 lakhs. So if you're in Meghalaya, then you don't have to register because you're, till now you're only at 13 lakhs. And guys, this was the registration chapter. Section 22 to section 30, 8-9 sections, guys, done really, really well with shortcuts like compulsory registration is needed tonight. The government hears you out with sections like, you know, PIGS, step one, step two, step three. All these are really, really short, good shortcuts. Can immediately comment 36 words. These are all shortcuts that will help you remember those sections so that you score great marks in your exam. I wish you luck and watch out for next videos as well. All the best.